And let's give a big Jen Blue welcome to retired First Lieutenant, United States Army, Purple Heart recipient, Bronze Star recipient, 2016 bronze medalist at the Paralympics in Brazil, Miss Melissa Stockwell.
Welcome. Thank you. Wow. I promise not to cannon any t-shirts at you. I'll give you a fair warning if I decide to do that. Thank you for having me. I'm here today to tell you a little bit about myself. And you can see that I have a little bit of a story to tell. So my story, at least the most dramatic part of it, was on April 13th of 2004. We were newly arrived in country. I was dedicated and eager to do my job, but it all happened so fast. The combination of a Humvee, a roadside bomb, and a lot of blood left me without my left leg. But what could be a tragic story is actually a story of tragedy turned into triumph. Because my story is actually an example that we all have the power to choose our own story, regardless of any obstacles that fate throws at us. And my goal today is that when I leave you and you walk out of this room, that you all end up greater people than the great people you already are. So I like to say that I was born a patriot, a lover of the red, the white, and the blue. And it started on the gymnastics mat because I was an avid gymnast, wanted to go to the Olympics, and I would go, and in that gym, I would stare at that American flag for hours at a time. And it turned into a deep love of the red, the white, and the blue, the American flag, and just really wanting to give back. So my story eventually led me to the University of Colorado, where I joined the ROTC program. And being able to be handed over my first uniform, put that uniform on, that flag patch on my shoulder, and the amount of pride I felt. I just knew that that's where I was supposed to be. And then a few years later, senior year in college, a day happened that changed the world, a day that none of us will ever forget, September 11th. And this day was a Tuesday, and like every other Tuesday, I was in my ROTC class with my uniform on, watching the news unfold on TV. And it was that day that our instructors told us that that uniform that I was so proud to wear on American soil, what I'd probably be wearing on foreign soil as well. But first, I was commissioned as a proud second lieutenant in the United States Army, a graduate from the University of Colorado, and set off to what was I thought was going to be 4 years, at least 4 years of service in the United States Army. The fateful day of April 13, 2004, really started out just like any other day. I woke up, we had our briefing, and it was a routine convoy from just north of Baghdad into what was called the Green Zone, which, if there's any cool place to go in Iraq, it was a Green Zone. There were Saddam's palaces across Sabres, and it was really supposed to be an easy day. I was going to take some pictures along the way. But as many of you know, life doesn't always go as planned. And a few miles into our route, we went under an underpass, and this big explosion goes off. I look up, and the windshield is cracked. Our vehicle swerves, we ricochet off of a guardrail, and we end up crashing into this Iraqi woman's house. Now, we had been over this in training, and everybody executed it perfectly. They got out of the vehicle, surrounded it, pointed their weapons out to figure out what the next course of action was going to be. I started to do just that. Reached over, took my seatbelt off, looked down, and I saw a lot of blood. And I called out, I was hurt. Something had happened to my leg. And lucky for me, there was a combat medic two vehicles back. He heard me calling out. He ran up, pulled me out of the vehicle by my bulletproof vest, laid me there. And like you would see in a movie, he started to save my life. I didn't know at the time, but my leg was gone. It had been severed. My eternal optimistic nature was thinking there was no way it was as bad as everyone else was making it out to be. But when he put the tourniquet on, and now years later, looking back at this picture, I know it was, in fact, much worse off than I thought. It was hard to believe that just 1 year earlier, I was at my first duty assignment in Fort Hood, Texas, thrown into it as a young 23-year-old, put in charge of thousands of dollars, millions of dollars worth of equipment. I was given a platoon that I was going to lead. And then a few months later, orders coming down that we were going to deploy over to Iraq. I knew my time was going to come, and here it was. So in March of 2004, I boarded a plane with thousands of my best friends, headed over to Iraq in hopes that we can make a difference in the world. I had two jobs in Iraq. My first was my favorite because I got to be a platoon leader. I got to lead 20 of the best men and women that I've ever known. A lot of them just out of high school trying to find their way in the world. And they find themselves with me as their leader in this home away from home, this faraway land, and the camaraderie is stronger than ever. I was also a convoy commander, so being on the road a lot, and not always the best place to be, but in charge of delivering supplies from one point to the next, and in charge of the vehicles and the route and really everything that went into it. I was a proud soldier. I was proud to be serving my country. I was leading soldiers. I was carrying out missions. I just never thought that a roadside bomb was going to come in the mix. But it did. And from the sands of Iraq, I was lifted and put in the back of this pickup truck. I was driven to the nearest aid station, and I was wheeled into an American hospital, still with a T on my forehead that stood for tourniquet, into a life-saving surgery. And I woke up from that surgery, looked at the surgeon next to me, and I said, "Did something happen to my leg?" And that's when he told me it was gone. And he handed over a phone and said, "Do you want to call your parents?" And being a mother now, I can't imagine the horror of that phone call. But knowing that this day is a day that my real life's journey began. And from Iraq, I was sent to Walter Reed Army Medical Center, which at the time is where all the wounded soldiers went from Iraq and Afghanistan. And it was there that my parents met me, always ones to be by my side through thick and thin. And there in the coming weeks and months, as I learned to live my life with one leg. Now, Walter Reed is a really powerful place. If you've ever been, you know what I mean. But when I was able to look around and see my surroundings, I saw so many other soldiers that were worse off than I was, missing 2, 3, 4 limbs, traumatic brain injuries, they had lost their eyesight. And I looked at myself and I thought, holy cow, am I lucky? And I made a choice. I made a conscious decision to accept the loss of my leg, a decision to not let it define me, because I wanted to live my life for those that gave the ultimate sacrifice. The weeks turned to months, but eventually I was down in the physical therapy room, getting fit with my first prosthetic leg. Now, it's an interesting process and one that you never expect to have to go through, but about 2 months after I lost my leg, I was handed over this piece of metal and plastic, and they said, "And now you're going to walk." I thought, well, how the heck am I going to walk with this? Like, I don't remember learning how to walk when I was younger, and now this. But I remember looking across the physical therapy room and seeing a gentleman missing both of his legs and an arm, and he was walking. So what excuse did I have? Perspective. It's really all around us. So I started in the parallel bars, eventually moved to crutches, and then a cane. And then eventually, I knew that life would go on. I would be independent, and my life could go on just as anybody else's life did. And as great as this was, I knew I wouldn't really be myself until I got back into athletics. I was a big gymnast, I was always an athlete, and I think once an athlete, always an athlete. So as exciting as this was, even more exciting is what I like to call Melissa Stockwell 2.0. Now, at Walter Reed, we were very fortunate. There's all these organizations whose mission is to get these wounded soldiers like myself out of our hospital beds and out doing things that we never thought we would do, you know, much less with two legs and definitely not with one. So I tried to take the opportunities that were presented, and before I knew it, I was out in Colorado learning how to ski on one leg. I had skied with both of my legs my entire life, but here I was on the bunny slope, one leg, these little poles that have skis on the end of them, pretty wobbly at first, and thinking, how on earth am I going to ever go up that ski, that chairlift? But by the end of the week, finding myself all the way up, coming down on the verge of being reckless, the wind in my hair, and I had never felt so free in my entire life. And I went back to Walter Reed, and I thought, if I can do that, well, then I can do anything. And it came at a really good time because someone came to the hospital to talk about the U.S. Paralympics, which at the time I knew nothing about, which is crazy because it's such a big part of my life now. But I learned, I sat in a room, and I learned that if I trained hard enough, if I worked hard enough and dedicated myself to a goal, that I could compete on the world's biggest athletic stage wearing a USA uniform and representing a country that I had defended over in Iraq. It was an easy dream, and a dream was born. First, I was medically retired from the Army. I did receive a Purple Heart and a Bronze Star. But what it really did... But what it really did is change my entire outlook on life. And somehow this dream of being a Paralympian, somehow I was going to make it a reality. And I chose to do this in the sport of swimming. It was easy for me. I didn't have to wear a prosthetic leg. I could get in the water, get some laps in, and the water really made me feel whole again. And I really put everything on hold to try to make this happen. I moved out to Colorado Springs. I lived at the Olympic Training Center. I swam, I ate, I slept. I learned to love the smell of chlorine. And then almost 4 years to the day, just like the Olympics, there's a Paralympic trials. And I went into it a total long shot to make the team. My times were here, they needed to be here. And I learned a pretty cool lesson at the trials, and that hard work pays off. And I broke American records. I did more with my swimming than I ever thought I was capable of. And the following day, when I was named to the U.S. Paralympic swim team, the whole journey from Baghdad, and now I was going to go to Beijing, and it just all made sense. And then the next stop was Beijing. And standing in the renowned water cube with my coach, imagining myself on top of that podium with that gold medal, hearing the national anthem, because what greater honor would that be? And I wish I could tell you that that did happen, but it didn't. I swam in 3 events. I didn't have best times. I didn't make finals. And at the end of it, I got a participation medal, which I wanted to chuck out the window because I thought I came all this way, and that's all I got. And I really thought I had let everybody down, my coaches, my country, my family, my teammates. And it wasn't until a few days later, when the closing ceremonies came around and someone is nominated to carry the American flag from Team USA, and it's typically reserved for someone who's done well athletically. But when my team nominated me, I learned a lesson that it's not always about the medals. It's not always about being on top. It's about the journey. It's about overcoming the obstacles and choosing to make the most of them. And walking into a sold-out stadium with flashes going off, carrying this object that I was so passionate about. Talk about moments you want to relive over and over. This was one of them. So now what? I swam in Beijing. I carried the flag. Well, triathlon would be a natural next step, right? So a year after I got back from Beijing, I was invited to do a triathlon. So swim, bike, and run. Yes, I still think triathletes are crazy. But I went, I did this race, and I was hooked. I loved being on the same course as able-bodied athletes. I loved the different challenges of all three, the swim, the bike, and the run, crossing that finish line. And I became very passionate about the sport early on. And turns out I wasn't so bad at it, and I've been able to compete around the nation and around the world. And to come across the finish line first at 3 different world championships with the signature move of the... Thank you. Of the flag, holding the flag as I run through that finish line. And I can tell you that standing on top of that podium, that never gets old. But it's been about 12 and a half years since I lost my leg. I'm a proud American. I'm a proud amputee, and I really show off my leg whenever I can. And every year on April 13th, we actually have a celebration. Sounds silly, but we have what is called Little Leg's Birthday. And instead of mourning what I've lost, we celebrate what we have. It's a celebration of life, a celebration of having my life and all of ours, and just remembering to remember that every day. People fly in, there's party favors, we may or may not drink out of my leg, but that's for those that come to find out. But it's really a day of reflection. And I've had some pretty incredible opportunities these past 12 years. I've been able to ride a bike and share a dance with George W. Bush. I've been able to get a presidential kiss. A presidential kiss as I presented him with an American flag that flew over the Olympic Village in Beijing. Been able to share my story with Katie Couric and her viewers. A fist bump with Tom Brokaw. I've been able to stand in a room with all five living presidents and their spouses on a day that wasn't about politics, but it was about believing in America. In the opening of President Bush's library, where I got to say the Pledge of Allegiance and talk about going home that night and just red, white, and blue just coming out of every pore, just the realization of how lucky we are. But with all of this, or a few others, sharing a laugh with the First Lady, and then riding a bike around D.C. with our current president. But out of all of these, what I'm most proud of is really giving back. I wouldn't be here today if it weren't for so many that have helped me, and having a nonprofit back in Chicago that gets athletes with physical disabilities into the sport of triathlon and just really giving back to that next generation. Out of all of that, this is my proudest moment. And then, of course, personally, my family. My husband, Brian, of 2 years, my son, Dallas, and a whole new meaning of wanting to dream big in hopes that he grows up seeing his mom dream big and that he will have big dreams of his own. So 12 and a half years it's been, and I've learned a lot along the way. As many of you know, life is short. I think we all know that. I've learned that, as you saw on the video before, when it comes to dogs, a dog can not just be a man's best friend, but a woman's best friend as well. And for all of you ladies out there, I know you'll appreciate this, that toenail polish does come off a prosthetic foot. What I've really learned is that dreams can come true. And just 1 month ago, my dream came true as I was competing along Copacabana Beach, swimming, biking, and running down the roads of Rio on a date, September 11th of 2016, and a moment where I got to cross that finish line in third place, getting that bronze medal with two of my teammates in first and second. A bronze medal that felt like my personal gold, and standing on that podium, seeing not one but three American flags on September 11th, and just from knowing the meaning of that. And being able to give my husband and my father a hug where the tears of joy instead of the tears of not doing well. And then being able to go home back to my son, put my medal around his neck. And yes, we did have large size jumbo heads of Dallas in Rio. But to close, I want to share with you some things that I've learned in hopes that you can all take them with you. The first is that life never goes as planned. I know you all know that. There are twists and turns, there are obstacles that come your way. And we all have the ability to get through them, if only you try. And in doing that and trying, we really make ourselves better. Second, you should always believe in yourself. Believe in yourself even when you doubt yourself. Don't let any temporary setbacks swallow up any positive attributes that are there. They're always there. Change. Change can be hard. I can tell you that my change was not easy. But again, if you embrace it, a lot of times we end up even better on the other side. Look around. You guys are a team. Your family is a team, your friends, your coworkers. Find people, trust on them, rely on them, because we're all in this life together. And lastly, if you start each day out with a positive outlook, it might be your best day yet. I promise you that any difficulties that come your way, there is something desirable about them. So I've just told you my story, and I hope that if you had the chance to come and tell me yours, that you'd be proud of it. And if not, now's the time to make that choice. Thank you. And because you're dog lovers, this is my service dog, Jake. Thank you. But I just want to close with, we all have a choice in life. We can choose what happens when we overcome. We can choose our life. We all have the power of choice, and choose to make your life a good one. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mrs. Melissa Stockwell. How about that, huh? Thank you so much. And Jake.